Welcome to the fourth and final part of my adventure in Sicily, a journey with Trafalgar across the southernmost region of Italy. In this 9-day tour that began in the colorful capital, Palermo, we traveled along the coastline to visit the popular beach destination of Cefalù and up the charming mountaintop village of Erice. We continued southwards along the shores of the Mediterranean to Marsala, the world-famous wine-producing commune, and to Agrigento to view the ancient ruins of the Valley of the Temples. In the Val di Noto, we wandered through the unique Baroque streetscape of Ragusa and Modica and traveled to the legendary port city of Siracusa. In the final leg of this journey, we head up to the Ionian coast in the shadow of Mount Etna to explore the hidden treasures of Catania, the photogenic village of Sabocca, featured in the films of Francis Ford Coppola, before ending the trip in the luxury holiday destination, Taormina. So join me this one last time in Sicily. I'm David Zeldran, and this is Executive Class. If you've been following my journey from the beginning, you'll recall the many times I've mentioned the rich soil of Sicily, the fertile farmlands that produce some of the finest products of Italy. That's thanks in part to Mount Etna, which on a clear day looms large above the land. And though the eruptions from Europe's most active volcano have fertilized the soil for centuries, her fury has altered the life and the look of the area surrounding cities, Catania most especially. Catania is Sicily's largest city and one of its unluckiest, perhaps. Sicily's eastern port has seen disaster strike too many times over the millennia. Earthquakes and eruptions caused by Mount Etna that have buried the city 7 times already. But it's a blessing in a way. Each time Catania was rebuilt, the city turned out more beautiful than previously. And the late Baroque style that's common throughout Sicily is, well, rather uncommon here. Indeed, some of the most impressive structures in the historic center have a distinct dark gray shade. The ornately designed Catania Cathedral in the Piazza Duomo, most notably. The drab color seems to dominate the main streets and squares, a shade of gray caused by soot from exposure to volcanic ash in the air, and the colors of stones made from volcanic matter.
Catania has been called the great city, but there's nothing to do with being dull at all. It has to do with the color of many of the buildings here, which use some kind of volcanic material. On the other hand, Catania is the opposite of dull. It's extremely lively. It has an extremely colorful market, and of course, it's also the home of opera and comedy in this part of Sicily.
Catania, after all, is the artistic and cultural center of the eastern region of Sicily, with an opera and theater scene that rivals Palermo and Napoli.
So if Syracuse has Archimedes as their most famous son, Catania has Vincenzo Bellini, the great opera master.
Catania is also one of Italy's foremost academic centers. The University of Catania, founded in 1434, is the oldest in Sicily, one of the largest in the country. Everything is old or gray, of course. The streets are lively with a cosmopolitan vibe you don't feel in most parts of Sicily.
So here, amidst these gray buildings and behind this fountain, is one of the other hidden treasures of Catania. It's their world-famous fish market, which people have a hard time finding. Right behind this fountain, and I can't wait to show it to you. They've got practically every variety of fish or shellfish or anything that swims in the Mediterranean and beyond over here. But if you're not into fish or seafood, well, there's another colorful market next door.
Yeah,
goes on and on and on, streets and side streets of vegetables, fruits, more seafood, spices. It's really more like a bazaar or a souk over here.
Fresh fruit and vegetable market, the largest in Sicily, reminds us that while Mount Etna has caused Catania's population so much misery, she's also provided them with its rich agricultural bounty. Indeed, despite her destructive power, locals have learned to live, even thrive in the shadow of Mount Etna. And when the volcano isn't causing tremors or spewing lava, trekkers and tour groups are even allowed to visit her upper slopes and craters. Right up to Mount Etna's peak reveals a completely different landscape about every 5 minutes. Charming villages one moment, fruit orchards and grape vineyards the next. And higher up the road, darkened forests and completely charred slopes. Much of this is off limits except the rare moments when Etna is sleeping and cars and hikers are allowed to climb up to see its craters about 2,000 meters above sea level.
So this is where I get off, and this is the closest to the summit that the bus can get to. Now from this point you get off and you can choose your path to any one of the craters here.
The slopes around the ski resort can be covered on foot, although the soft ground and steep inclines can be challenging even to experienced climbers. But they also provide majestic views of the surrounding countryside and the Ionian coastline.
Whenever you drive along the coast, you're always staring at the beauty of Mount Etna above. Now this is your chance to see what it looks like from Mount Etna looking below. And the view is just as spectacular. Over there, if you look closely, you'll see another crater of Mount Etna. I'm not sure if it's safe to walk down there, but let's just keep our distance for now. But everywhere you look, you see all these black lava. That's because Mount Etna is constantly erupting. Although peacefully and slowly, it's constantly erupting.
It seems like a wasteland from up here, or a furnace even, which ancient Greeks and Romans once believed to be the domain of the fire god Vulcan. But the earth blackened and burnt from lava flows, and the ash that falls on the ground below. These bring life to the best-known wine, pistachios, oranges, and lemon varieties of Sicily.
So yes, Mount Etna is destructive, as you can see, but she's also nurturing. Because over the years, this will become some of the most fertile land in Sicily.
Indeed, Mount Etna's history of destruction is probably the only other thing that's more violent than organized crime here. And though it's no longer as common to encounter the mafia personally in this area of Sicily, you can at least find Hollywood's version of it in this idyllic mountaintop village. Savoca perched on a high rock above a winding road overlooking the Strait of Messina on one side and the snow-capped peak of Mount Etna on another, was where a medieval citadel with a famous silk industry was once established. It's a sleepy village of just over 70 residents today, known for little else than its spectacular mountaintop location and panoramic views, its charming cobblestone streets and local delicacies. Or, if you're a fan of Francis Ford Coppola's Godfather series, as a Sicilian hideaway of Al Pacino's character, Michael Corleone.
As you can see, it's a truly romantic scene. No wonder Francis Ford Coppola was captivated by Savoca. And if you walk around the streets, you might recognize some of the scenes from Godfather 1. But first, just a backstory of how Coppola ended up in this remote town on the coast of Messina. His first choice, of course, was Corleone, a town closer to Palermo. But of course, the locals gave him a bit of trouble. Maybe the mafia had something to do with it. Whatever the true reason was, he had to scout for another location. And he was pointed to this place, Savoca. And immediately he fell in love and he filmed some of the most iconic scenes from that film right here. Including the famous wedding scene in the local church. Let's take a look at it.
The steep walk up to the church is worth it, even if you're not interested in the Godfather setting. You get these amazing eagle's eye views of the natural scenery and of the ancient castle walls that tower above everything. But yes, it's a church made famous by Coppola that most tourists rush to see.
So here we are at the end dish of a very lovely and scenic walk through the village. You reach the church that everyone talks about. This is the Church of San Nicola, Saint Nicholas. And it's an otherwise unremarkable church for Sicilian standards. What makes it different and special is that this was the church where Michael and Apollonia had their wedding. It's a pilgrimage church. That is, if you're on a Godfather pilgrimage.
Benedizio de Onipotentis, Padre, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen.
Strangely, Coppola didn't film the wedding vows at the altar, where all Catholic Sicilians are married. Apparently, the parish priest refused, although the priest did agree to play the role of one when the original actor failed to show up on set. Parish priest Coppola hired other locals to play themselves. Francesca, our Trafalgar guide, helped me find Signora Vicenza, who played the bride's mom, Signora Vitelli.
So she's gonna come out and show me a very popular photo. So this is really cool.
Ah!
Quella sono io. Bella, bella. Most beautiful woman in all of Sicilia.
Most tourists, even Godfather fanatics, often pass her by without even noticing. Though Vicenza is a local celebrity here, as is anyone or anything related to the scenes Francis Ford Coppola filmed in this remote corner of Sicily.
There's a reason why they're crowding here. It's not because they have good coffee. Just kidding, they probably have good coffee and good breakfast. But the reason why they're lining up is because this was another famous scene in The Godfather. Do you remember?
Porto vino. Vino, questa è una bottiglia, non è una poca bicchiere. Salutiamo, signore.
The cafe became so famous, the owners even renamed it Bar Vitelli, after the family name of Apollonia. And right across, another iconic scene. This was where the wedding reception took place, and the main plaza, or piazza, the square.
If retracing Al Pacino's footsteps in Savoca doesn't interest you, don't worry. The charming village life and the mountain views are well worth the tour here. When we return after the break, I bid farewell to Sicily, the ancient ruins, and sun-kissed streets of Taormina, and say goodbye to my fellow travelers in a private villa overlooking the Strait of Messina.